Rick's Corner, the man, the legend, now on with the show.
Welcome to Rick's Corner. I have a guest today who came all the way down from the Bay Area to see me to get on the show. He's a filmmaker and he used to train at Joe Gold's Gym on Second Street in Santa Monica years ago. That was the first move they made from Brooks and Pacific, and then from there they moved to Hampton. So they moved three times,
yeah.
So this is the second move. Anyway, it was a unique gym, and it was good for what it was back in the day, right?
Yeah, oh yeah, it was.
The building was owned by Robert Blake.
Yes, he did own it,
yeah.
And offered it to Ken.
Yeah.
Ken Sprague, the owner.
That's right. And I think that's where, the gym started taking off prior to that, but once it got there, it started to really boom, and they started doing contests and making into what it became like a iconic gym. I mean, the original was iconic, but this even took it to another level. Because in the 80s, you had a whole different group of superstar bodybuilders.
Yeah.
In the 70s, you had the golden era, which then you had the 80s, and then you had the 90s, and everything kind of changed on through those decades. But to me, the 70s was the best. That's the golden era.
I agree.
So what prompted you to want to do a documentary on this?
Well, I was a member. I was a kid looking at bodybuilding magazines that had you in them, Arnold, Ken Waller, all the Weider superstars.
Mm-hmm.
And my buddy and I, we were probably sophomores or juniors in high school when the book Pumping Iron came out. So we looked at this, and it was, as you know, in the middle 70s, bodybuilding, you guys were like from Mars. I mean, very
rare. Yeah.
You know, and so we're like, wow. And, you know, we grew up in Southern California, went to high school down here, and we're like, this isn't too far from where we're at right now.
Yeah.
So, you know, we just thought, oh, this is kind of neat. But at the time, we couldn't drive. About a year and a half later, we have our driver's license, and we decide to drive out to Gold's Gym. And we realize that, oh, the Gold's Gym in the book Pumping Iron is now a home.
Yeah, it's a home.
Where's Gold's, you know? So, we did some detective work and found it on 2nd Street. We had asked some guy at a gas station. He says, it's on 2nd and Broadway. And we walked in, and basically, like a lot of people said, like the people that saw the original gym that would come in on Pacific,
yeah,
the magazines came to life. And that was my, I think, original impetus, and fell in love with it. I felt a little, even when I walked into the one in 2nd, and I loved that gym,
yeah.
I felt like, oh, I missed the party. Because what was chronicled in Pumping Iron,
yeah,
the book, so much of that whole lifestyle was what you guys were doing, the way you were just living life on your own terms. You know, everyone looked smiling.
Yeah,
and happy.
It was different. I mean, you missed, you were a day late.
Yes, yes.
The 70s, the gym back then, held a lot of camaraderie. I'll cut that out. But there was a party life, there was a social life, there were things where we all hung together. And then when it moved to 2nd Street, a lot of that had disappeared.
Mm-hmm.
You still had some of the same guys, but a lot of the guys moved over to, I believe, to World Gym at that point.
Yeah, that's right.
When Joe built it on Main Street. And so the people who stuck by Joe went to World Gym and they trained there, which was a great gym.
Yes.
So now you had two gyms not really competing, but kind of competing in a way. Even though Joe Gold originated Gold's, he also originated World, and so it's the same guy. But it was a different breed in the 80s down there, a different group of guys. The styles had changed a lot. You know, the baggy pants and the rag tops and the hairstyles and all that kind of stuff. But the equipment was good, and it was a good gym to train in.
Yeah, oh yeah. I mean, myself as well, I didn't go to the Hampton gym. I did for about a week.
Yeah.
And
that's totally different too.
Yeah. Oh, absolutely. I mean, when I was at 2nd Street gym, and Pete Samra and Kent Keene were the front desk managers.
Mm-hmm.
You know, Waller and Grant and Robbie and then Menser, Yeah, that was kind of like, I think Robbie and Mensa were kind of like the next generation from the Arnold.
Yes.
You know, and of course Zane had moved over to World.
Yeah.
But I liked it, and when I interviewed John Balick, you know, the publisher of Iron Man, and he had said, he goes, I thought Ken did a good job in recreating the original feel of Goals. He said, because the building was kind of funky like the original, just larger. Just a bit larger. Obviously, he said, you know, the Marjanians and the original core, which included you, Franco, Arnold, Zabo, and Eddie, moved over to World.
Yeah.
But I enjoyed Golds on second, and you know, Weider was in there quite a bit with Bill Reynolds and Craig Dietz and the other photographers, yeah, doing all the magazine photo shoots. And then when Ken did sell to Kimber and
yeah,
when Ken did sell to Kimber and Grimkowski and Connors, there was a fourth gentleman.
There was Tim Kimber, Grimkowski, Connors.
Was it Helms?
I don't know. Was it Rich Minzer?
Oh God, I think it may have been. But they called them the Four Horsemen.
Yeah,
and I went, and of course. Gold's 2 on 2nd Street was riding the wave of what was built at the original Gold.
Yeah.
And it was with the publicity that Gaines and Butler had given it with the book Pumping Iron. And then, of course, filming the movie there, that kind of like built the interest in the mainstream media, mm-hmm, and for the average Joe.
Well, yeah, that and the magazines, and you know, the magazines took everybody and made them superstars. So guys around the world would see this and say, man, that's where I got to go work out. I got to work out with those guys. Because when I walked into Gold's Gym in 1969, there was Draper and Zane and Arnold, and Arnold had just got there, and a couple of guys, and no one really knew much about it. I didn't know what it was. I was training at Bill Pearl's in Pasadena.
Yes.
So it was a completely different thing for me. But when I went in there and I thought, well, it's an old rundown brick building, but my God, they got good equipment.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. I think it was John Balick, who had mentioned that he felt that the original Gold, he said, aside from being a charter member, which he was, mm-hmm, and I think he said Joe paid, I think the charter members, it was like $40.
$40 a year, yeah.
Yeah, for lifetime membership. He said it was more, he goes, it wasn't even really a business. Mm-hmm. He says it was a place for Joe's friends to train.
That's exactly what it was.
And that was just, he goes, you know, Joe just wanted to play volleyball and then come in and lift weights, and his buddies were there and they lifted weights.
Well, Joe had a lot of property he bought down there years ago, back in the 40s and 50s, that you could buy a beach property for like $5,000.
Yeah.
And so he bought several lots around him, the one on Main Street as well. And he knew how to build, and so he built a center block building and made it a gym. Built all of his own equipment, put a heater on top that he never plugged in, he said. Put a water fountain, a payphone on the wall, and he's ready to go.
Yeah.
One dressing room, one shower for men. There was no women. But if the women finally joined, they had to use the same shower. So that's how he looked at it. He didn't care. He was just like, this is how it is. If you like it, you can live here. If you don't, leave. But it changed a lot over the years. Even today, it's like nothing like it used to be. In the Hampton Gym, which is Gold's Gym where it is now, they still call the Mecca of bodybuilding. And I suppose it is down there. It's not the same. First of all, everybody's gone.
Right.
Everybody's gone. It's all a new breed of people with their headsets and their water bottles, and they don't talk. They train okay. There's a lot of people in good shape. And you got about 5 or 6 guys that are really about 300 pounders, mm-hmm, that train really heavy, you know, walking around with their workout bag and their bottle of water dangling behind them, and none of them have jobs.
Yeah.
You know, they just kind of come and go all day long and hang out in the parking lot. So it's a different deal than it was. And someone said, how come you didn't have water bottles in the gym back then? I said, because there was none. Yeah. We just had a water fountain. They didn't make water bottles or cell phones back in those days, you know?
Yeah.
So we did the best we could. And as far as cardio goes, they wanted to know about cardio. I said, there was none. You know, you take a jog on the beach once in a while, but it wasn't a steady thing.
Yeah.
So then you decided to do, how long ago did you decide to do this documentary?
You know, it was a couple years ago. I had, and one, it was a personal journey for me. And it was something that came out of my personal life, just in terms of, you know, you have ups and downs in life. Which I won't get into, but I work at a TV station in the Bay Area. I started working in television in Los Angeles in 1987. Mm-hmm. I was up in the Bay Area, and this is a couple years ago, and there was a guy, a gentleman named Mike Murphy, who runs a cancer foundation, and he owns a couple businesses. And I saw him on our public service show that airs like Sunday mornings. And he just seemed like a very magnetic personality, a guy that helps people. And I went to his website just out of curiosity. And it says he also does life coaching. So I'm like, what do I have to lose?
Yeah.
You know, email him, figure I'll never hear back from him. A couple weeks pass, I never do. And I figure, well, he's a busy guy. He was on Larry King's show. He's traveling.
Yeah.
You know, he was in different magazines. I figured, okay. Probably about a month after I emailed him, I come downstairs after a nap, and there's a message on my phone. And it's like, hey, Mark, this is Mike Murphy. I'm sorry.
Wow.
He says, I'm so sorry. He goes, usually the emails to that kind of get buried. This is my personal number. I read your email. Here's my address at my office if you want to come talk. You know, so we made an appointment, and we must have spoke for close to 2 hours the first time we met. And then the second time I met him, he says, you know, we're going through what I want to change in my life, what I want to do. And he says, what do you really want to do? And I said, you know, Mike, I go, in another lifetime, between the time I was like 17 and 23, I used to compete in bodybuilding contests. And I said, and I worked out at the Gold's Gym when it was still only one in the world, and it was on 2nd Street. And I said, for some reason, that still resonates in my mind and in my experience in terms of what it made me as a person later on in life. And I think I want to do a documentary on it. I said, I know some of the people I'm still in contact with, and we'll see how this goes. So that was kind of the general impetus. Mm-hmm. And when I started it, because my experience was a 2nd Street gym, you know, between 1977 and about the time Ken had sold it in late 79, I think. And I said, that was that period. And that was probably the height of Gold's fame, I think, for probably us old timers, so to speak, just in terms of promotions.
Yeah.
You know, the 77 Mr. America contest, the 77 parade, 60 Minutes had covered them. You know, the events, I think Ken's event, the 77 America and Parade, he said had more press requests than that year's Academy Awards.
Yeah.
So it was something that I'm like, that will never happen again in bodybuilding. And it even afterward.
Never again.
But for some reason, I think just being there, meeting the different people that I met, you know, like, you know, when I met you at World and Richard Jekyll, who was one of the actors, and just the different actors that I had met, different people from all walks of life in both of those gyms, that's what I told them. I said, for some reason, it's still in my craw, and I want to tell a story. I said, because I don't think a good story has been told yet on it, because a lot of it's been forgotten.
There have been stories. I don't know of any really good ones yet. Yeah.
Yeah. So, I think that's just it. As a people figure, oh, it's not worth the time, so we're not going to do it. So the history kind of gets changed or kind of gets mishmashed, you know. So I thought, well, you know, for what it's worth for the period I was there, and then I could talk to the guys that were there before me, you know, with you, John Balick, Ken Spray, Ken Waller, Bill Grant, Dave Dupree.
Okay, so and we're at that point right here. Let's talk about the clips, and let's just name one for example. And then what I'll do is I'll show you guys the clip that he sent me, and then we'll discuss, and we'll go on to the next person, the next person, the next person. This is the best way to do it.
Sounds good.
Okay, so who's the first name you come up with?
Oh, let's go John Balick.
Okay. John Balick was the owner of Iron Man magazine. He was a bodybuilding competitor as well, and he became a photographer for bodybuilding. If I cough like that, just give me 5 seconds, and then I'll cut it out.
No worries.
It's a chronic cough from having bronchitis. John Balick was very well known in the business, still is to this day, and gets involved in the beach contest. So we'll run this little, what's about a minute?
Yeah.
About a minute clip on John Balick.
I always wanted to live in Southern California, and it was basically because of bodybuilding. I was, you know, I started working out as an eighth grader in 1956, and of course started to read the magazines, Iron Man first, and eventually Muscle Power, then and Mr. America. And of course there was the glamour of the beach, the women, the sun. And growing up in Chicago, which we had Lake Michigan, but it was like 3 months of the year. So it was really a tremendous draw for me. That was my goal. When I graduated from college, I immediately came out here. I graduated as a civil engineer, and I actually had a job out here before I graduated. So I had a built-in reason to come here, and a way to keep myself alive financially. So that was what got me to Southern California was, without question, bodybuilding. That was my dream.
Was that the California Dreaming Club? I think was John's impetus when I asked him how he got started in bodybuilding. And he had come out from Chicago as a civil engineer, I believe.
Right.
And just a engaging, wonderful man, and one, a very good competitor, mm-hmm. as you could see from mm-hmm. and there's some photos on the internet of John. And he trained with Arnold for a bit too.
Yeah.
And one thing that was interesting with John throughout the interview was he was actually there with Arnold the day that George Butler and Charles Gaines walked into Arnold's place and pitched him the idea of the book Pumping Iron. So at the time, I'm thinking, I'm getting this wonderful interview with John Balick, but now I'm going to have to try and get Charles Gaines.
Go ahead.
So, but anyway, John, aside from being a great competitor, photographer, publisher, he had a great, great insight. I think beyond the guys that are like in the trenches,
yeah.
Since he kind of moved away and started chronicling it, he had great perspective.
Yeah, he had an overview from it.
Yeah.
Who's next?
Ken Sprague.
Ken Sprague's a character.
Yes. Yeah. You know, he. What intrigued me about Ken was how he said Gold's. It was kind of an afterthought when he bought it. Not really an afterthought, but just he said, I think they looked at me like, do you want to buy it? He was like, he says, I think Dave Sachs and Bud Danitz mm-hmm. looked at him like, either someone buys this place or we turn it into an antique
right.
shop.
Let's watch this clip on Ken Sprague. He's an interesting guy. I still see him today. I mean, I still communicate with him. But he turned the gym into something that became very, very famous by running shows and sponsoring bodybuilding shows. So watch this clip. It's pretty interesting.
Something came to me. At that time, Gold's Gym never had a t-shirt.
I think we ordered initially about half a dozen t-shirts. I thought, who would want a Gold's Gym t-shirt?
They didn't have anything, no logo, no nothing.
Ken Waller came up with the idea.
Actually, Rick Drasin, a lot of people don't know this, made a drawing for me. I came up to this area, which is Oakland, and I went to a bar, nightclub, or whatever, and there was a band up there called Mr. Clean and something. And so when I got back, I talked to Rick, and I said, hey, Rick, I said, get yourself a Mr. Clean bottle and make me a drawing of Mr. Clean with a barbell.
He gave an artist, Rick Drasin, a gym member, a Mr. Clean bottle.
Here's how that happened. I had designed the Gold's Gym logo in 1973 on a napkin in Zookie's Deli with Ken Waller. I think Ken Sprague might have been there.
He says, I want the t-shirt to look like this, except with a barbell.
So Rick made a bald-headed man look sort of like Mr. Clean with a lot more muscle, and he put a barbell in the middle of it, and the barbell was straight. I said, everything's good, Rick, except we're just going to bend the barbell.
Mr. Clean will clean your whole house and everything that's in it. Mr. Clean, Mr. Clean, Mr. Clean.
So they printed up all these shirts, maybe a dozen or two, and they sold them all out the first day.
And sure enough, that goofy old Gold's Gym logo was born.
And that's where the original logo came from that we put on the Gold's Gym stuff.
Well, slowly we'd get letters from people around the country, can I buy one of those t-shirts? And it built from there, and then thousands by the time I sold, many thousands a month.
And so they started selling more and more, and it became, over the years, the largest selling logo in the world.
When I talked to Ken Sprague, he remembers it. He says, I think you paid Rick $25 to draw that.
I never got a dime for it. I just said, take it. I didn't realize this.
And then from that point on, that propelled it into the general public.
I don't remember that at all. I just remember that Rick drew it for me.
Ken was a boxer.
Yes.
He was a bodybuilder. I don't know if he competed, but he had a great body. But he did put a lot of effort in the gym, took a lot of pride in it, and his wife helped him promote the shows, and she passed away with throat cancer, I don't know, a year or two after that. But he carried it on, and he did a good job with that gym.
Yeah, he, like you said, at first, when he purchased it, he just wanted to keep it open and train at the beach. He didn't want to go inland. And like he said, he was surprised that Golds had never promoted a bodybuilding contest before. So I think it was a Mr. Western America.
Yeah, well, that gym would never work inland. It has to be on the beach.
Yes, yeah.
That's the only way that gym would work. I know Bud Dennis and Dave Sachs had it for a year, and like you said, they didn't know what to do with it. They weren't promoters. They weren't very outgoing people. Mm-hmm. Bud was in the antique business, and Dave worked for aerospace. They just wanted the gym. Didn't make any money with it. I think they sold it pretty cheap.
Yeah, I think Ken said that he had to come up with $15,000 down and then assume the liabilities of the mortgages. And I guess Danitz and Sachs had also bought the surrounding property around it, a house on one
right,
side.
Right, the house on the other side, yeah.
Yeah. So that.
And he eventually turned that house into part of his house, which was part of the gym.
Yeah, yeah.
So it was all connected.
Yeah, that's right. That was, I think to me, that was just one of the most interesting things to people out there today. And Gold's Gym is this monolithic brand, to think that at one time it would have never been.
No, it's a beautiful home inside. I've been in there.
Yeah, I saw that.
It's very beautiful. All right, so let's talk about Charles Gaines.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, Charles wrote the book Pumping Iron, as you said, and then they did a documentary on it and had cameras all over the gym. So let's show this little clip on Charles, because it's something where he talks about it and it's very interesting. We'll be right back.
I'm not sure that he had seen the potential for his business when we were doing the preparation of the book. And we were just two journalists from the East Coast who were out there. We didn't mean anything to Ken. You know, he had guys wandering in off the street from the Weider magazines who were doing stories all the time. They were not important to him, and neither were we. But by the time we came out to do the film, the book had come out and had a big success and put bodybuilding on the map. And at that point, he was willing to do pretty much anything he could do to help us out, which was self-interested, but also great for us.
Pumping Iron, for example, came in to film at Gold's. That was an interesting story.
There was never a question of where we were going to concentrate our efforts for the book preparation and in the movie preparation. And we were very fortunate to have Ken Sprague, who owned it at the time, who was hip to movies, knew about movies, and who saw, I think, the potential for his business.
Having some knowledge of the production end of motion pictures, I told Butler, come on in here, string your lights. Go ahead and string your lights on the ceiling. We had high ceilings.
And so he allowed us to put up lights in the gym and keep them there permanently. He allowed us to move equipment around.
And I said, anytime you want to film, since Pumping Iron was a documentary, you just come in and essentially throw the switch for the lights and you're ready to go.
Allowed us to shoot in the gym when it was closed, if we wanted to, bring people in there like Arnold and set up scenes, because this was a feature documentary. We had a lot of set up scenes.
Gold became the focal point for Pumping Iron.
It was a set. It was a working set for Ken. Well, we couldn't have gotten that in another gym.
So now, what about Charles Gaines?
Well, Charles, he was a wonderful gentleman that invited me to Alabama. And I stayed at his place for 3 days, and we conducted the interview over that time. And he was an author, a published author, and his initial, love of bodybuilding started in Birmingham, Alabama, when he started lifting weights at the Birmingham Y.
Mm-hmm.
And his wife, Patricia, said that when they met in college, she said, I thought he looked funny because he was a big man. Charles was about 6'2", and at his peak, he was about 240. She said, but I thought his head looked too tiny for his body. And she said, and I found out he's one of those weird guys that lifted weights.
Yeah.
She said, but he was also this very intelligent man who was an author. And because of his background in lifting, when he was doing his different journalistic jobs, Sports Illustrated had decided to write about bodybuilding. And that was the contest at Mount Holyoke, Massachusetts in the Northeast back in the early 70s, and Arnold was the guest poser. So Charles got the assignment, and he got assigned George Butler. as the photographer mm-hmm. for that contest. And he said, we met Arnold, who was the guest poser, and he says, I turned to George Butler, and I just said, this guy's going to be a star. He goes, no one knows about him now. He's the king of 300 people. He goes, but whatever he does, he's going to do it big.
Yeah.
So I think coming out of that, he had gone back to his publisher because he had had, he was working on his novel, Stay Hungry, if it hadn't already been published at the time. And that was one of the interesting things. If I can backtrack a little bit, I'm kind of ping-ponging. But I had asked Charles, I said, did you write Stay Hungry before or after meeting Arnold? Because of the Joe Santo character,
sure.
this larger-than-life messianic character that just leads people. And he says, I wrote it before I met Arnold. Hmm. He said, but when I met Arnold, I'm like, if this ever gets made into a movie, he's got to be Joe Santo.
Oh, I never knew that.
Yeah, it was just so interesting. He uh-huh. says, he did base the Joe Santo character on a guy that he dedicated Pumping Iron to called Joe Disco, a man named Joe Disco. And he said, but Arnold was even just obviously, manifest anything tenfold from what anyone else has ever seen.
Yeah, he was the guy.
Yeah.
Okay, you also, who's next? Was it Dave Dupree?
I interviewed Dave Dupree.
Okay, he's been around a long time. He always stayed in great shape.
Yes.
And I'd see him down at Venice Beach once in a while, and he hung out with us. We did some movie, I don't think it was that one over there. It could have been with Sextet. We did a couple of shows together. He came out on him. But let's run the clip on Dave. Interesting guy and still in great shape.
My first reaction was to comic books. Charles Atlas ads in the back of the comic books. I always admired strong men, and my first movie was seeing the movie Samson and Delilah with Victor Mature. I was 6 years old.
Now relive the colossal drama of the mightiest colossus that ever lived. Samson and Delilah, the immortal story of the strongest man in all history.
And I said, can people really be that strong, or is that really a Samson? And I start reading the Bible, there was a strong man named Samson. And then Steve Reeves came along and I said, wow, if I'm going to be a bodybuilder, this is what he should look like, perfectly proportioned, so the people will admire you and not be a monster. And Steve Reeves was my inspiration. After seeing Hercules at 16 years old, I was hooked.
Hercules!
I didn't want to be anything but a bodybuilder. When I was 16 years old, I thought I was well built enough to enter a contest. I was walking along Haight Street in San Francisco, and there was a movie theater showing, I remember the movie to this day, it was an Ed Wood movie, Glenn or Glenda. But they had a contest. Who is the real Mr. San Francisco? We want you to enter our contest. See who is the real Mr. San Francisco. I was 16 years old and I entered. I walked up on the stage with grown men, but I won in my underwear. And one of the people in the theater came up and said, how old are you? What are you doing in here? I said, I want to enter the contest. I want to be a bodybuilder. He said, you're too young to be in here. Are they making any passes? That guy was J. Edgar Hoover. So that was a true story. So eventually he said, you should be Mr. America. I want you to keep your nose clean. Because at that time, there was a teenage bodybuilder picture scandal going on. And teenage boys were being lured into posing nude. And I thought there was nothing wrong with it, but it was the big thing in the 60s. A lot of those photographers served time in jail because of sending those nude photos of teenagers through the mail.
How old is Dave now?
I think Dave is close to 80.
Yeah.
And he, the ironic thing, when I was contacting all these guys and trying to get all the people I interviewed together, and Dave was up in the Bay Area near me, and he was actually the TV station I work at's in Oakland, mm-hmm. and there's a nice lake called Lake Merritt, with the nice apartment buildings around it, and it's very scenic. And I found out that Dave walks around that lake daily with like a 25-30 pound weight vest. Yeah, I mean, and he's still, I mean, he's close to 80, but he's still in great shape.
Yeah, he is.
Yeah. A Bay Area guy, and he would come down here. He said he had an aunt that lived down here in Los Angeles, so he would come down and lift at the Venice Beach weight pit, and then he said he would go into Gold's, but obviously back in those days, and this was still the 60s, he says hardly anyone was in there. You know, he said, but I liked it because I like training alone.
Yeah, yeah, he's yeah. like that. Who would be next? Ken Waller's quite a guy. To this day, he's still quite a guy. I saw him at the Gold's Gym convention in 2000. I don't know, I'm going to go way back. Maybe it was 2002, and he had not trained in years, he said. But watch this little clip on.
When I first started lifting weights, it was when I was a senior in high school. I was a wrestler, and I hadn't been defeated. And I wrestled a guy from Evansville North, and we were in a tri meet, and the guy pinned my biggest competitor in my area in 16 seconds. And I went, holy mackerel, what am I gonna do now? So I spent 3 rounds on my back trying to keep from getting pinned. And from that day on, I started lifting weights. I gained 30 pounds the first year I started lifting weights and growing like crazy. Went down to Western Kentucky, and they didn't even have weights down there at that time. I walked on, actually, at Western Kentucky and told the coach when I went down there, I says, if I make your team, you pay for it. If I don't make it, I'll pay for it. Well, within a month, I had everything paid for. And that's basically my history is getting into weightlifting. It's basically, it was just athletics. It wasn't for bodybuilding at all.
Okay, let's get back into Ken a little bit.
Yeah.
He was available easily enough for the interview?
Yeah, you know, he was living in Kentucky, but he was very pleasant on the phone when I contacted him a few years ago, and I'd stayed in contact with Ken Sprague, so Ken had called me, and he says, I just want you to know, he goes, I'm getting calls from these guys, because I don't expect them to remember some 17-year-old kid at Gold's Gym back in the 70s, you know. Mm-hmm. But he says, they're vetting you. They just want to make sure that you're serious about this, and I'm vouching for you, you know. And I said, no, I understand. And Ken Sprague had said, because you have to understand, a lot of these guys have been promised stuff through the years.
Oh, they've been burnt over and over.
Yeah, that's never come through.
Yeah.
You know, so I said, you know, I understand that. And Waller was wonderful. I mean, just an engaging guy, mm-hmm. Totally different from what people think he is in Pumping Iron. Which,
well, he was pretty much of a tough guy back in those days.
Yeah.
As a bouncer, and he used to pick fights and things like that. He was tough. But he had a heart of gold. He was always very, very good to me. And I always appreciate his friendship. Good friend. Very good friend. Who do we have next?
Bill Grant.
Oh, Bill Grant. Bill Grant's funny. I get tons of messages on Facebook from Bill. He's got a great sense of humor. He's been on my show a couple of times. Let's watch this.
We all had individual looks. We didn't look the same. Now, today, if you look at them, they kind of all like the kind of cookie cutter, right? But now, remember, at the one Olympia that Arnold had one year, he had a silhouette. So the guys would come up to the silhouette and hit their famous pose, and the audience had to figure out who it was, but we were all individual, and they got it right. Frank Zane, Bill Grant. I mean, then Robbie, bingo. So, I mean, it's like they all knew who it was. I mean, we had individual bodies. I don't even know how the judges could do it because we were all, you know, great in our own time.
Okay, so Bill is easy to get.
Yeah, Bill was a wonderful guy. I think we spoke on the phone for 45 minutes from the initial phone call.
Well, he's a talker.
Yes, he is. And but he has so much to say.
Oh yeah.
And when Ken's wife Donna who was kind enough to transcribe these interviews. You know, all the interviews, I would send her the audio file via Dropbox, and then she would transcribe the written word of everybody, you know, and Bill was close to about 90 minutes of pure audio. But when I combed through it, stuff that I didn't think I would use from Bill turned out to be fantastic.
Yeah.
You know, and he kind of, he reiterates what you say about that era, because there's just this one soundbite that that he said that really sums it up. And he said, I'm trying to explain to, he goes, and I've been doing this since the 90s, explaining to the kids that I run into that ask me about that. And he said, if I could put you in a time machine and take you to that era, to that gym, he said, you would never want to come back.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and it was so so pure what he said, because mm-hmm. it captures that time in essence.
That's very true. That's it. He and I used to hang out together. We did some TV shows together as well, and we'd ride together and hang out together and train together. We trained together 4 days a week because he was working at the airlines.
Mm-hmm.
And so the four-day-a-week routine for me worked out pretty good. I kind of liked it rather than 6 days, but no, back to six. But he knew what he was doing. I'll say that for him.
Yeah. Yeah, he's, and he, you know, very passionate about bodybuilding. Still training people in New Jersey and New York.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Who's up next?
Let me see. Wayne Galash. Wayne Galash.
Oh, Wayne Galash. Okay.
Yes. Yeah, you know, Wayne, I had actually did a Facebook friend request with Wayne because I knew that he had shot footage of the 1977 Mr. America Parade.
Mm-hmm.
And at the time when this project started, that's what this film was about. And it's kind of grown.
Was this the parade in Santa Monica?
It was.
Oh, we're going to show that. Watch this right now.
With that parade, I wanted to present bodybuilding in a fun way.
I don't know if it's very well known, but nothing like this had ever been done before.
I'm thinking, oh shit, that's, I don't know how they, bodybuilders in a parade, who's gonna come see us?
The Mr. America Day Parade took bodybuilding into another dimension.
Bodybuilders atop elephants.
Says, hey, you ever rode an elephant? I said, no, but I'm all for it.
You ride an elephant? I said, yeah.
I said, yes, they told me we're gonna climb some elephants.
Elephants in the street, bodybuilders on elephants, marching bands.
Bodybuilders on floats, bodybuilders carrying banners, bodybuilders.
It was something that was like a scene out of a movie.
Yeah, that's funny, that parade. Okay, so go ahead.
Yeah, so you know, Wayne was kind enough to accept the request. We exchanged emails, and I told him what I was attempting to do. And as Wayne, being a filmmaker, you know, he said, "Oh no, absolutely, I can get you the film." And we agreed on a price, and because that's basically, I think, other than footage shot by Ken, had a film crew shoot the parade for multi-cam from different angles, but Ken said, I probably lost it in a move somewhere along the line. I know 60 Minutes used it when they did a profile on bodybuilding, which included Ken and Arnold and a few other people. But Wayne is, aside from being, back in the day, a pretty darn good competitor in Australia and a powerlifter.
Mm-hmm.
Without Wayne, I think a lot of bodybuilding history is lost.
Yeah.
If you don't have Wayne, because I think he's the only one who has footage of Arnold at his initial NABBA Mr. Universe appearance and win. And so many, as you know, so many photographs, just reams and reams of photographs for years.
Many.
Yeah. And also, the films. When he would come out, he said, I'd come out to the United States once a year, and then I would obviously try and I have to make my pilgrimage to Gold's, because I knew that's where the top guys were. And usually when they were preparing for the contest, they were in shape, and I could film them for a fee.
Yeah.
You know, and got a lot of top competitors. I mean, a lot of the history is because of Wayne.
When I was young, my father always had a good physique, and he played football and all the different sports. And so he had always been interested in being strong and being fit and healthy. And then, of course, he was a footballer. So I suppose he was the role model for me for sport and strength. And then in my late teenage years, I used to play a lot of squash. And one of my great rivals joined a gym because he wanted to try and get a step ahead of me. So I thought, well, I better join a gym too. And it all started from there when I was around about 20 years old. My interest in bodybuilding grew only because I was interested in strength and fitness. When I was at the gym, after a short period of training, the people around me in the gym encouraged me to go in a bodybuilding contest. And yet that was the last thing on my mind when I joined a gym. I just wanted to get stronger so that I would be better at sport. So I said, okay, I'll go in a competition. It was a local gym competition. So unfortunately I won that, and then I went into open competitions in the state level and so on. When I was competing, and in my last major year in bodybuilding competition was 1968, there was nobody filming the events. It wasn't considered important. It wasn't considered something that was worth even considering. So there was no film ever shot of my career in bodybuilding. It was a film I organized to be shot at the beach with pumping and posing with my training partners, and that was in 1968. So after I stopped competing in 1968 and I just did powerlifting in 1969 and 70, I thought, well, I want to make a record of it.
Yeah, I know, he was a big name in the sport. Who did we leave out?
Let's see, Rudy Hermosillo and Pete Samra?
I don't have Rudy, I have Pete.
Okay, I didn't send you Rudy, okay. Yeah, Pete, you know what, I may not have, yeah.
Yeah, Pete Samra, well, it speaks for itself, but he came to me when he has his supplement line, he asked me to do a logo for him for his supplements with two wings, and so that's what he used for his logo for years.
Samra Nutrition.
Samra Nutrition, right. So let's watch this.
My first person that influenced me to becoming a bodybuilder was Rich Park. You know, I was brought up in South Africa in Johannesburg. Rich Park was the greatest bodybuilder in the world at the time. And our school had bought some type of exercise equipment for the kids to play on, like they call a jungle gym. He had come to do an exhibition at a school fair, and he brought two other Mr. Universes with him, Yanni Graf, who was a height class winner at the NABBA Universe, and Frans van der Berg. And when I saw Reg at 11 years of age, I said, that's how I want to look one day. Reading the muscle magazines, the Weider magazines, everything was about Gold's Gym. And Gold's Gym was like this thing that you had to go to Gold's Gym to make it. And when I walked into the Gold's Gym in Venice, the first original Gold's, it was like all of these bodybuilders that I'd read about as a kid popped out of the magazines. And they actually looked bigger and more impressive than in the actual magazines.
Is Pete still around today?
Pete is in Arizona. He's a minister, and he preaches around the world. He just got back he's from South Africa, and he had returned from South Africa. He's been to Great Britain to preach. He does it around the country, and he has a ministry in Sunrise, Arizona. Still trains, and still trains people. Trains female physique competitors and male competitors.
Awesome.
Yeah, and just a wonderful, kind-hearted guy.
Yeah, you know, you stay active at that age, my age or that age. You stay active, you'll stay active forever.
Yeah.
I don't know how some people just quit and they don't do anything and their just body just goes and they don't care anymore.
Yeah.
It's sad.
It is. But yeah, you know, Pete was the guy when I originally joined Gold's. He was the guy that had signed me up. Yeah, just a really nice.
Oh, very nice guy.
Yeah, just a kind-hearted guy, and then ran into him at World, obviously, because Joe Gold had let him put his supplements in the gym.
Hey, let me put my T-shirts in there too. I had different designs.
Yeah.
Behind the desk and on the counter, he was good about that. So who did we leave out?
Oh, let's see. Did I send you everything? I'm trying to think who I sent. Did I send you anything on Doug Brignoli or
no?
Okay, I have Doug, but I didn't.
There's only one guy you left out.
Oh. You. Well, let's see. We did talk about you in the Golds thing, and then let's talk about Bakersfield's own Rick Tracy.
was in high school and I was a lead guitarist in a rock band. I was about 145 pounds. I was a junior in high school and my girlfriend was a senior. Now, you know, she was an older woman. She was a homecoming queen, head of the swim team, really, really pretty girl. And she lived with her cousins. Uncle was a realtor and she had two cousins that lived there, football players. And I knew them. So I said, I want to start working out. She said, why don't you just go to school, work out, and Dan and Mike, they work out in the backyard almost every day, and you can do it that way. I said, okay. So I went over there, and they had a barbecue bench and barbells. We'd load up, and we'd do bench presses, and we'd do curls. And those benches back then were really wide. The barbecue bench, they really hurt your back when you land. I mean, it was miserable. So I tried it, and I went for a while, and I thought, no, I think I'll go to the YMCA. So I found the YMCA, and of course, their weights were really nice. They were kind of beat up and bent, and dumbbells had to be tightened up. But I did make good gains there. I made good progress. This is in 1961. It's my junior year, and all of a sudden I start to see my body start to respond like really well. I knew nothing about steroids. I knew nothing about diet. I just worked out. I spent most of my time playing in the band, my music on Friday and Saturday nights, and going to the gym. When everybody else was having fun on Friday night drinking, I'm in the gym working out. I'll meet you guys later.
Okay, so let's talk about what you wanted to talk about.
Yeah, well, I met you at World Gym.
Yeah.
And at the time, you were jogging quite a bit. You were actually down in body weight, and I don't know if you were, I don't think you were wrestling at the time, but this was probably late 70s.
Yeah, right? I don't know. I can't, kind of went in and out of it.
Yeah.
And I bought this house out here, and so I was jogging at the park. It was like 105 degrees.
Yeah.
I was just dropping weight like mad. And they wanted me for a TV show. They wanted me to be lean. I ended up dropping weight, which I wasn't really crazy about, but I did it. Then I started putting the weight back down, training hard. But I bought this house in 79, and it's worth about, I think they said about $800,000 now, and I paid $86,000 for it.
Yeah, that's appreciated. That's California.
Yeah,
real estate.
It's crazy.
Yeah.
So go on.
Well, you know, one thing that I consider myself lucky about, and I think another thing when I started this project, was when I went back to the internet and I saw all these people talking about golden age, golden era, and the gyms that made, you know, that mm-hmm. made that.
Mm-hmm.
And I was thinking, well, I was there. I was a member of both Gold's on 2nd Street and World on Main Street,
mm-hmm.
Both at for 1 year there, mm-hmm. 79. I was going back between both. And when I saw all the names that they were referencing, and I'm thinking, I used to train next to them. I would talk to them, and you know, when I was at World, and I was talking to Zabo one time after workout, and Artie Zeller's there, you know, and I just knew Artie as Artie.
Yeah.
And then I started like finding out and talking to people. They're like, oh yeah, you know all those photos in the magazines? That's Artie.
He took the best photos.
Yeah, he did, and used natural light.
Mm-hmm.
And then, you know, when I'm talking to Eddie one time, and I was talking to you, you had drawn a picture that someone put up on the bulletin board, and it just, whatever it was, you skewered someone pretty good, and they probably deserved it. I'm an artist like you, and I used to get suspended from school for doing little animated flip books of my adversaries. And I was talking to him. I said, yeah, you know, that's pretty good. And he goes, well, he does all the t-shirts. He goes, he also trained with Arnold. And I said, yeah. And then so him and Zabo were telling me, like, at the old gym on Pacific, that you and Ken Waller and Arnold would train. And those were those things that I realized, kind of like the bodybuilding history I was around,
mm-hmm.
you know, because it's not like you came up and said, I used to be Arnold. You never mentioned it. You know, you were just, you know, we talked to Rick Drasin after a workout, or you would, you know, whoever was in the gym.
Yeah.
And then I think it was actually some articles in a magazine that I read about you that I think Dr. Wong's Muscle Digest.
Oh, sure.
Yeah. Yeah, he probably did a couple articles. I'm like, wow, you know, pretty unassuming guy. You know, you were very friendly and very funny. Which I appreciated, you know, because sometimes, you know, working out some days, you know, sometimes it's a drag or guys take it, you know, a little too seriously.
Yeah.
So it broke some of the tension with some levity.
Yeah.
You know, and then finding out that you were responsible for the logo of both gyms.
Yeah.
You know,
people find that out and they're like, really? I'm shocked. I didn't know that.
Yeah.
But it just went that time. It didn't mean a whole lot. You just did it.
Yeah, who knew? I mean, who knew that those, well, I guess the magazines, right? The magazines control the narrative that made it something that people around the country and around the world wanted to come, because we would see it every, you saw it at Gold on Pacific, and then also on at World on Main, where you knew in the summer, I mean, most people that walked up the steps and into the little cubicle with Eddie and Zabo, they were from somewhere, right?
Yeah,
and they wanted, they were buying stacks and stacks of t-shirts and sweatsuits.
The funny thing is, I get calls a day from gyms and people for different businesses, and they want me to draw a logo for them based on the history of that and the fact that I was so-called famous from doing it in their eyes. To me, I'm just a guy. So I draw a logo, and they say, but we need your signature. That's where the value is. So I said, okay, fine.
Okay.
I don't charge them a whole lot. You know, they're just going to have fun with it. But it things have changed over the years, and I think what you're doing now with the documentary needs to be done. Just like the 350 days on wrestling, like the way they did that was like perfect, and what you're doing probably will be pretty much parallel, if not better. How much more do you have to do on it?
I'm trying to get one more interview.
With Arnold.
With Arnold.
Okay.
And at the time, I think when I was at Charles Gaines' house, and I woke up the next morning, I had done part of the interview. I'd interviewed him in two parts.
Mm-hmm.
And when he was referencing how much he had to go through to get the book Pumping Iron even okayed, and then get the budget for it, and then get it published, and then all, you know, of obviously talking so much about that gym and Arnold, and I woke up one morning, I'm like, oh, I'm gonna have to get Arnold. I was like, I probably have a better shot flying to Saturn before tomorrow.
You'd have a good shot at getting Franco.
Yes, yeah.
Franco did my show. He was great.
Yeah, he's you know, I called his publicist, haven't heard back yet. But they add so much.
Lynn?
Yes, Lynn.
Use my name.
Okay, I'll do that next time.
Here.
Yeah, I hate to.
She's real nice.
Okay.
Yeah, if you use my name, tell her you just did the show about the documentary, you want to interview him, she'll set it up.
Okay. Well, you know,
and I'll actually shoot her an email too.
Okay, great. That would help. And you know, one thing about you, aside from your introduction, which with the clip and the weight game, you know, you're an artist. So you're a musician, and you're an artist, and you're editing your show, which I think probably played into your foray into bodybuilding, even though you were first and foremost a wrestler, but you did compete too in a couple.
I did for a short time, and Arnold would come and judge this and that, and I started thinking, okay, there's a trophy, there's dust, there's money, but it's not dusty.
Yeah.
So I'd rather make the money from wrestling with my body than get a trophy for it, because it didn't pay the bills.
Yeah. Oh yeah.
So I said, okay, I'm just going to continue to wrestle, train like a bodybuilder, train with those guys. They're training for the Olympia. I'm training to wrestle at the Olympic Auditorium and these other venues, and I'll train the same way and have the same body. I'll just put it on stage a different way.
Yeah.
And it worked.
Oh yeah, absolutely. And then I mean, from that came what, magazine photo shoots, movie parts, commercials.
Oh my God, so much. I was able to retire from SAG with a pension and full medical. I had done, I don't know, 75 commercials and several TV shows and movies, and the movie Ben with the Rats and the Incredible Hulk, the Demi Hulk on the TV series, The Shield as a bad guy. I mean, FBI series, Cher, Johnny Carson, Flip Wilson. I mean, it goes on.
Yeah.
But back in those days, it wasn't that difficult to get the work. And because I was seen on TV here in Channel 13 and Channel 52, people knew me.
Mm-hmm.
And it's the media world over here in Hollywood. And
right.
So, oh, there's Rick Grayson. He's a wrestler. Let's bring him in on something. And then one day they had a casting call, and it was really funny. My agent called me. He said, I just saw a call. He said, they're looking for a Rick Grayson lookalike. Really? What about me? Now they want the lookalike. Or type, something they said.
So there funny. You go. That shows you made it. And in fact, I walked in a SAG check for you today from your mailbox.
Oh, sure, right? Did. That'll pay the cleaning lady.
So, when you mentioned the Hulk, because you know it was Lou and Manuel Perry, and then you were the Demo Hulk, and was Toby Hoffman, and was there others, or was it just you?
No, there was
guys?
Bixby, Manny double Lou. I was the middle Hulk. So, when Bixby got stuck in the middle, that was me.
Okay.
And then he went to Lou. So they called it the Demi Hulk.
Okay. And did Toby Hoffman do it as well for a bit? No? And you, Mr. Florida.
I don't know about Toby Hoffman. I used to see him at the gym. I know he told me a lot of things that he had done, and people said, yeah, I don't know if I believe him. So that's the word that I had, so I don't know if he did or not. I never heard about him on the set.
Oh, okay. Okay.
So I know that Manny did, of course. And Manny's black, and they painted him green.
Yeah. Well, that's what he said. He goes, I can't. He goes, I'm black. I'm not going to do it. And Ken Keene said, my God. They just paint you green.
Just paint you green. And the stuff they put on you smells really good. It's very floral-like. So, yeah, that's who it was. But I'm really looking forward to seeing this put together.
Yeah, me too. It's been... I started this in late 2015. And I do have a full-time career. Had a television station in the Bay Area. So I try and carve out time in between. But with the last push... hopefully get this into post.
Yeah, and then, you got to get it in there.
So. Yeah, and get it moving along. So I appreciate you though letting.
Oh, you kidding me?
Viewers know
this is a privilege and this is an honor to have you here to talk about this because this will go down in history and this show will be on the internet forever.
Yes, that's true. That's true.
Thank you, Mark.
Oh, thank you.
I appreciate
Rick.
It. Now we'll go stick it into my computer and see what we come up with.
There you go.
Thank you guys for watching Rick Schoner and thank Mark for being here. You're going to see a lot of things on the history of bodybuilding. What's the title?
Right now, the working title is Gold Strike from Pacific to Second.
Oh, I like that.
Yeah.
Cool. Stay tuned for that, and we'll see you guys next time. Hey, everyone. Now you can have the Gold's Gym logo drawn by me, the artist Rick Drasin, personalized and made out to you and signed by me to frame and put on your gym wall or wherever you see fit to do so. It's a piece of bodybuilding history. It will never be duplicated again. It's the largest selling icon t-shirt logo in the world. And I'm the guy that drew it. And I will draw it for you. Just go to my website, rickdrasin.com, and order there. You can pay through PayPal, and it'll be sent out right away. And be sure to watch Rick's Corner for all the videos on bodybuilding, nutrition, fitness, pro wrestling, and anything that suits your interest as far as getting physically fit and being the best you can be from the golden era of bodybuilding.
Baby, see you next time.